As we bid goodbye to 2023, we thought we'd take a look back at some of our favorite episodes and most popular stories. What were they? Find out now on The State We're In. Hello, welcome to The State We're In. I'm Melanie Plenda. Today, we're here to look back at 2023 on The State We're In. We had some great discussions this year. Our most popular topics included our show on the active tick season this year, the presence of neo-Nazis in New Hampshire, student loans, and talking to children about war. Viewers especially responded to our health coverage, including our first episode of 2023, which dealt with the triple-demic, the confluence of COVID, RSV, and the flu. The convergence of these viruses caused an uptick in trips to the doctor and hospitalizations, as well as shortages in some over-the-counter medications, especially for children. Here, Dr. Alok Kole, an infectious disease specialist at Cheshire Medical Center, a member of the Dartmouth Health System in Keene, talked about what was going on.
We've seen way more influenza than we've seen in the last 2 years. We continue to see COVID. We saw a lot of RSV in October and November, which is thankfully dwindling down as of now. But we're still in the midst of our winter season, our typical respiratory virus season. And so it may be too soon to call the trajectory, but continues to be busy at this time on the inpatient side and even in our outpatient clinics.
Hospitals were braced for a busy season with these three viruses circulating as they are now. One thing Dr. Kole advised was to get vaccinated as soon as possible.
I'll first address the safety part, Melanie. I think we now have, from the time they got their emergency use authorization, we have 2 years worth of data. And if you count the trials that went into getting that emergency use authorization, it's almost close to 3 years. And the number of vaccines that have been delivered across the US and globally, there are very few other medications that can talk about such robust data backing their safety. Yes, are there some side effects? Are there potential adverse events? That's always the case, but that can be even with routine medications and regular treatments. But that should not prevent someone from going ahead and getting it. But the unfortunate part is those things often get highlighted more than the benefit. I think from an efficacy perspective, you know, to set the record straight, people need to understand that vaccines are not 100%. They're not 100% efficacious. They never were. They never will be. We talked in the earlier phases of COVID-19, the vaccines that were developed were really effective in even preventing infection. And as the variants have evolved and become more immune evasive, that may not be the case. However, they still stand the test of time when it comes to progression to severe disease or people ending up getting hospitalized and what the vaccines can do to prevent that. I think that efficacy still continues to stand tall and especially is made more robust by the updated booster because we've seen variants come and go. However, these vaccines, especially the updated one, does potentially have cross-reactivity and protection even against the newer variant that's come out right now, which is being talked about in the Northeast called XBB 1.5. So, and the interesting part is we continue to monitor the data. We've not given up on looking at the safety and efficacy, and it continues to show glorious results. So I think, it is time we move on from that discussion to say whether vaccines are effective or not. They are effective, they are safe, and it's time we get them.
Still sound advice for right now, as all three viruses are back in circulation again. Later in the year, we talked about, unfortunately, a topic that comes up frequently, gun violence. For another year, mass shootings dominated the headlines in and around New Hampshire. Here, Zandra Rice Hawkins, Executive Director of Granite State Progress and part of the Gun Sense NH project, talked about some of the work her group has been doing this year to advocate for gun control laws.
We have been working as the New Hampshire Gun Violence Prevention Coalition to pass core gun violence prevention bills. These include things like closing background check loopholes, passing gun-free schools, because we do not have a state law around gun-free schools, making sure we have extreme risk protection orders in place. So if somebody has exhibited a dangerous pattern of behavior, has access to firearms and is a danger to themselves or others, that we have a way to help provide some safety for that individual and those around them, and waiting periods, which these vary from state to state, but this is a policy to institute a waiting period of between 3 to 7 days, so that after somebody purchases a firearm, there's actually a little bit of time between the purchase and delivery. This helps with two major things. It provides a cooling off period for those who may be in crisis, and prevent them from causing harm to themselves if they're they need some intervention, and suicide is something that they're considering. And we all know that suicide by firearm is unfortunately a uniquely lethal way, and that oftentimes individuals who are in that crisis and use that, it is harder to then save their life. The other part is a cooling off for somebody who may be considering harm to others, and giving that little bit of distance, that little bit of time for people to have a second thought and not have immediate access to a firearm is a public safety protocol that we should have in place. And then we explored other things like improving our safe storage laws. So the idea that you should safely store firearms around children and just not have general access to your firearms, and conversations about what the liability should be for gun owners who do not take that precaution.
Interesting. So did any of these laws pass?
They did not pass. And this is not the first time we have put up bills like this, particularly on closing background check loopholes. We have put this legislation in for nearly a decade now. And the truth is, on gun violence prevention, the public is there, and the public has been there for a very long time. We all see what is happening around the country. We see what is happening in our own state. And we want common sense public safety laws to not make access to firearms so easy that even convicted felons and domestic abusers can get those firearms, and to put in other public safety protocols that will lead to safer, stronger communities. But the political will has not been there. And so we've either had these bills get defeated in the House and the Senate, or we had the entire package of gun violence prevention bills vetoed by Governor Chris Sununu a couple of years ago.
It's no secret that gun rights advocates think New Hampshire doesn't need any more laws. Here's Zandra and firearms consultant Tom Brown discuss that dichotomy.
We already have common sense gun laws. None of the proposed things are common sense in any way. Felons already cannot possess firearms. If you're currently under a domestic violence protection order or civil stalking order, you cannot possess a firearm. So there are plenty of things in place, but let's face it, people who are going to commit a crime don't really care what the gun laws are. Firearms are prevalent. There are over somewhere between 400 million and 500 million guns in this country, and you are not going to stop someone who has evil intent from getting their hands on a firearm. All these proposed laws do is stop the honest, law-abiding citizen from accessing what they see as their God-given right.
Sure. And Zandra, would you like to respond to that? Because I know that is an argument that is often out there, that, you know, well, it's not going to stop anything, and, you know, we already have these laws on the books. So how would you talk about that? What do you think about
that? Background checks is a great example of this. So we do have background checks in place if somebody buys from a federally licensed dealer. So this is like if they go to a gun store and want to purchase a firearm. We know from the data from those point of sales and the background checks conducted that that has been an extremely effective policy at keeping guns out of the hands of convicted felons, domestic abusers, and others. What the problem is that we have major gaps in that. So private sales are not subject to a background check in New Hampshire. And we need to close those loopholes to make it harder for individuals who should not have access to firearms to not have access to them. So while it's true that we do have background checks for some types of gun sales, we do need them for every gun sale.
And I do want to move on to other questions, but Tom, is there anything else you'd want to add in response to that?
Well, the reason why we don't need a background check for a person, New Hampshire resident, New Hampshire resident sale, and that's just because of the nature of our state and the freedom. And the background check hasn't kept anybody from purchasing a firearm. I mean, prior to 1994, when the Brady Act was enacted, half the states already had waiting periods, and there was no statistical difference between the states that had waiting periods and the states that didn't have waiting periods. So it sounds nice, like people are going to cool off while they're waiting for their firearm. One, it assumes that this is the very first firearm they're going to purchase when they don't have other firearms at home or other firearms they could borrow or steal or buy on the black market. So you're not restricting any criminal's access to firearm or someone who wants to do evil by having a waiting period or closing what is not a loophole. It's just called freedom. If you don't like freedom, then fine, say that. It's not a loophole when two residents can exchange and purchase an item. I can sell lots of items to other New Hampshire residents. I don't have to go through the state or the federal system to do that. Why would firearms be any different?
That's another topic I'm sure we'll be coming back to in the new year. Next is one of our favorite episodes and an issue near and dear to our hearts. It tackled the state of local journalism in New Hampshire. Here, Anne-Marie Timmons, senior reporter for the New Hampshire Bulletin, talks about some of the bigger issues facing local news.
I guess I'd start by saying I think we're really lucky here. We have a very strong news presence. There's so many different kinds, and a lot of it's free to read, thanks in large part to the Collaborative and other nonprofits. But that's not to say that there aren't challenges right now. You know, I was at the Concord Monitor for about 20-ish years, and when I was there, we had 15 reporters on staff, and we always felt like, why are they starving us of resources? I think they're down to 5 reporters now and still managed to get the paper out. So I think what I'm seeing generally is newsrooms are shrinking, but the demands for news every day remain. So I just think reporters are working on more stories with less time. That results in, you know, a very different kind of story than big takeaway investigative pieces. So I think the resources in New Hampshire are very strapped here. And I just don't know how a lot of my colleagues get news out every day. So I think that's a big picture. We're luckier than most in that we have so much free local news here, but it's hard to get it out. And I wonder how long some of us can continue to do that.
Julie Hershian-Hart, editor for the Laconia Daily Sun, pointed out the impact these issues have on the community.
Well, as Anne-Marie mentioned, now we're all trying to do more with less. So as our newsrooms are shrinking and as we have less resources, we still have the same number of stories that we have to cover. We still have the same number of towns that we have to deliver news on in our coverage area. So our community, with the advent of the internet and social media, is used to being able to access the information that they want immediately. And we have to do our best to keep pace with that while also prioritizing the most important stories and trying to balance delivering all of that information to our readers with less resources.
And here, Carol Robidoux, founder and publisher of Manchester Inklink, talks about ways news outlets are trying to keep local news sustainable.
I think that people are, you know, it's hard to break it all down in a soundbite or two, but there was a time when I worked in a newsroom and it was the night shift and somebody would come in from the advertising department and announce how big our news hole was going to be, which meant we had this amount of advertising and so we can allow this much space for news. So the amount of news that made it into the paper was reliant on having those big, you know, auto fare ads or other types of advertisements to support and sustain the product. When that changed and everything kind of got digital and people started using Facebook, people didn't necessarily feel the need to advertise in the same way. So then you have to start looking to readers. And then you have to decide if you should have a paywall, which is that thing that happens when you click on a news story and it says you're out of view, free views, or to read this story, it's just 99 cents or whatever that is. And people are reluctant to pay for news, although they will pay for a movie on Netflix or a subscription to iTunes so they can get all the music they need. So I think it's one of the challenges is making sure that our communities see us as an essential part of their everyday life, just like their entertainment and just like their relaxation or the causes that they support. A lot of newsrooms are following a nonprofit model, which makes people think perhaps that it's free and it doesn't need support because it's free. Let's just all participate in that and we never have to have any responsibility to pay for it. You know, we have a membership program. We don't charge subscriptions, but we do rely on advertising. And it's a hard sell sometimes because advertisers have to feel confident that people are coming to your new source and will appreciate ads as much as they're coming to read what happened at last night's meeting or what was the big protest downtown. So it's part education that needs to happen. You know, you get what you pay for. And I think if you want really solid, you know, that was part of the Granite State News Collaborative, the idea that we can, as a statewide collaboration, present to the public reliable news that everyone can count on. And it's without bias in that it's we all, you know, strive to have the same editorial milestones and present to the public what they're really looking for. You know, it's one of the top five things people say they read a newspaper for is connecting with their community. So if we're not doing that, if we're not relevant, then, you know, we will fold.
We'll definitely keep following this topic as well in 2024. Next, we tackled one of the topics that dominated news stories all year, affordable housing. New Hampshire, like many of its neighbors, is in the midst of an affordable housing crisis. Here, New Hampshire Housing Executive Director, CEO, Rob Dappas, talks about what can be done to ease the housing crunch.
Thank you. I'm glad you started with local because I think we see so many of the obstacles that prevent builders and the market from meeting the demand that's out there exist at the local level. And so planning and zoning regulations, I think, really need a new look. The New Hampshire legislature passed a great new program called the Housing Champions program. There's resources there to help municipalities update their zoning codes and then recognition for those that choose to do that. At the state level, as I mentioned, the Housing Champions program has been a nice bit of legislation that I think will help. Investments at the state level are really important too. And I think there are things that the state can do to limit the degree to which communities can restrict private property rights to develop land and property into housing that meets the needs of the people of New Hampshire. I think there's less that the federal government has in terms of their role in land use, but certainly the federal government can write the biggest checks. And as I mentioned earlier, it's vulnerable people who are most at risk in this kind of housing market. And so I think it's incumbent upon the federal government to keep making investments that protect people who are poor or have a disability or elderly to ensure that they have safe and decent housing.
The housing crunch will also be an ongoing story in 2024, and I'm sure we'll be revisiting that topic. And finally, we discussed another perennial topic, school funding. A recent judgment tied to a pair of lawsuits said the state was giving local towns too little aid and was distributing that aid in a way that wasn't constitutional. What does that mean for the future of school funding? Here, New Hampshire Bulletin reporter Ethan DeWitt discusses what comes next.
I think what everyone's immediately waiting for is the state's response. Essentially, the state will need to either appeal or file a motion to reconsider. So appealing would send either of these rulings straight up to the Supreme Court, motion to reconsider, might slow that down. But the judge, because he issued both of them on the same day, and these are momentous decisions, offered an extension to the state to do that. So we haven't seen that yet. We can all assume that they will be doing that. And that's important because we're right now in budgeting season for school districts. We're also in the tax rate setting season. So the Department of Revenue Administration right now determines what tax rates it will approve for different towns and cities. And if the SWEP tax, if this ruling were to stand as it is right now, and it does stand now, that would be, they would have to seriously rearrange how they are administering those taxes, because there would no longer be the ability for cities and towns to retain the excess SWEPT, as I mentioned before. So we can expect, I think, reasonably expect that decision to be stayed in some form or another, either by Ruoff because of a motion to reconsider, or by the state Supreme Court, which would then mean it wouldn't impact the tax season for next spring, but it hasn't happened yet. So of course, anything could happen. As for the rest of this, the question is kind of what the Supreme Court does here. You know, and they've really kind of, they're kind of teed up right here for a major decision. There was obviously two major decisions in the 90s. And when the Supreme Court got the Conval case the first time, it actually remanded it down to the Superior Court for additional hearings and for the decision we have here. So the Supreme Court now kind of has backed themselves into a corner where they kind of have to make a major decision here. And the question is whether they're going to take both of these cases, one of these cases, kind of splinter their decision, try to go for something narrow or go for something broad. And that's kind of what everyone is thinking about. But we're a few years out, I would say, from that. And the last thing to mention is that only one of these cases has been fully concluded at the Superior Court level. The second case, the Rand case, the taxpayer case, that was only filed last year. So they haven't even had a trial yet. So while while there was a ruling on one half of that case, the other half still needs to be adjudicated through a trial. And the attorneys for that lawsuit really want that to happen, the plaintiffs. So they're going to be having a whole nother trial that will again look at the adequacy formula. And so the Supreme Court may wait on that. So there's really a lot of uncertainty as to what the Supreme Court will decide to do here.
We'll also keep an eye on those lawsuits in 2024. We had some great discussions here on The State We're in 2023. We'd like to thank all of our guests for joining us to discuss these and so many other topics. Now here's a brief look back at our quotable highlights from all of our episodes.
New Hampshire is in the middle of a larger crisis related to mental health and our mental health system. And this goes from a shortage of mental health treatment professionals to maybe a lack of funding for Medicaid reimbursement rates, although there were some movement on that in this most recent budget cycle. How can we attract younger workers to this state, which connects to housing? So this is a very complex problem to solve. And that was just barely scratching the surface on what is happening there.
Everything upon which we depend on in this state requires people, and we just don't have enough people right now and certainly going into the future. So this is a priority, not just for our future success, but really to just to keep us afloat.
We believe strongly that government is by the people, of the people, and for the people. And so if it's by the people and of the people, then we want people to participate, not only in the big, in the regular sort of election cycles that occur every 2 years or 4 years, but we want people to participate every day.
What is it about this that is really striking a chord? And they realized it was simply that rural communities don't have natural density like urban areas do. And so while all of us are sort of in our own little pockets of the world solving problems, we can do that better together.
Local elections and local government in general are vitally important, but both the ordinary public and political scientists tend to overlook them. Turnout's about 25% or lower in a typical local election. Political science research gives them very little attention. My last job was actually working for the Center for Local Elections in American Politics, and we had the biggest data set ever of local elections in the U.S., and it only covered 12 states. So both the public and academia tend to overlook it. But the consequences of local elections are greater for the average American than the consequences of a federal or state election, at least under normal circumstances. Things like zoning, police, education, those are handled by and large at the local level. It isn't the state government in Concord or the national government in DC that is educating your children, overseeing the police, making sure your neighbor doesn't tear down their house and build a nightclub or something over there. It's those decisions are made in town hall.
The issues that are being dealt with at your town or your school or your village district, they may not be at the sort of front top of mind or on your radar, but technically those issues are affecting your daily life more than any other election or any other legislative process that you may be involved in.
I'm grateful for that 12-month on-ramp because I can't overstate how heavy a lift I think this is going to be. You have essentially nationwide three graduating classes of students who have never paid on their student loans.
The most important thing any of your viewers can take away from this is don't be afraid to ask your banker hard questions. How am I covered? Am I protected? Are you taking care of me? And remember, ultimately, the banks are in the business of value extraction, not value creation. So it's true now, as it always has been, caveat emptor, buyer beware. So know what your bank is doing with your deposits, and don't be afraid to ask questions.
We now have a new COVID-19 vaccine. It's formulated for the 2023-2024 respiratory virus season. And this really is becoming an annual vaccine. The idea is that we look at what is circulating in the community, we formulate a targeted vaccine that covers the majority of the viruses that are out there. You get that in the fall, and it has about 6 months of protection before it wanes. And the protection for severe illness and hospitalization probably lasts a little bit beyond that, but the protection against just getting sick in these winter months is really about 6 months in duration.
So we try to prioritize transparency in everything that we do, to try to invite the community in and see behind the scenes, see how we're doing our work, who it is in our newsroom that's doing that work so that they can connect with us when they see us out in the community.
What have you heard from farmers about how they're adapting to climate change and how much are they concerned about it?
Yeah, I think it's really a growing concern. In this year in particular, this past season that we had really highlighted kind of a lot of the future scenarios. So we're becoming more familiar with managing for drought and the high heat days. And so they're really struggling to adapt new technologies. A lot of these things have a price tag associated with them. And also the technical expertise in deploying these new technologies they need assistance with. And so, yeah, they bring it to us frequently, and it comes in all shapes and sizes. And so that's where we really rely on our team in Extension. We need sort of the breadth of pest management experts and disease experts, water irrigation experts. It's not just like one issue. It really affects sort of all the dynamics on a farm, including the economic piece as well.
We already have a lot, if not all, of the solutions to the climate crisis, whether we're talking about community energy programs or the transition to more green jobs or, you know, something like segregated waste collection mandates, right? We have all those solutions, and we just need to be listening to people who are talking about them and putting them in action.
More snow was reported in June of 2023 than in the month of June throughout the observatory's history. I believe it was 8.4 inches of snow this month. And that was just due to us being a little cooler than average and lots of precipitation, and it fell as snow at the beginning of this month. It's kind of transitioned more to rain now, but we'll see what happens before the end of the month.
Black bear by nature are more shy. You know, they tend to, if confronted, flee from that situation, versus brown bear tend to maybe be a little more aggressive if they are confronted.
And they are just an awe-inspiring act of nature that you can actually witness and observe without any optical aid, at least the total part of the eclipse. Like I mentioned, during the partial phases, you have to use the glasses or you have to project the image of the sun. But it is absolutely an awe-inspiring event for the amount of time that the sun is completely covered by the moon. It's just something that is completely out of our experience.
How does the process work with these service requests and the legislators?
Legislators file their requests with the Office of Legislative Services, government employees whose job is writing bills. So sometimes legislators come with mostly written bills, fully formed ideas, but other times it's a lot more sketchy and just a concept. After all, you don't have to be a lawyer to be a state legislator. We have citizen legislators. They're paid $100 a year plus mileage. So the professionals at the State House are there to help with the legalese. There is also an opportunity to file secret bill requests, which we see in the Senate. That gives legislators more time to work on the bill without alerting other people that might be interested in it. And so then they have that drafting process in secret.
Kids these days have been kids these days for an awful long time. And we have to respect that kids will always find novel ways to break the rules, novel ways to get in trouble, novel ways to just be kids. And cell phones have provided a new mechanism for that. But they haven't come up with new ideas yet. It's the same behavior in a new way.
There is, and this kind of gets at the heart of the debate over this bill, over whether materials that parents might object to should be removed wholesale from schools, or whether there are materials that parents can object to for their own children, but not removed from the school in general.
This is something that a whole lot of New Hampshire agrees on, but now a small but loud group of people and legislators are really orchestrating a strategic political backlash by exploiting fears against trans people and trying to make a national anti-trans agenda override New Hampshire's live free or die values.
We're taught not to talk about race. We're taught not to talk about gender. We're taught not to talk about politics, religion, and polite company. But if we don't have these conversations, then how do we really build what Martin Luther King called the beloved community? How do we come together to create a world where we all feel like we belong and are comfortable?
The first thing I would say in general around kids is, one, don't make assumptions. Always have the conversation. And also, and this can be really hard in these sort of divisive times, is remember kids need context more than they need our opinions or political positions, right? So try and give them a sense, you know, do your own research in terms of what is the context of what's happening in the world so that you have some sense. And it's okay, remember, that you don't know everything.
Conversation continues online. What was your favorite episode? We'd love to hear from you. Visit our Facebook page at collaborativenh.org and use the hashtag #YearInReview. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.